It's not going to work. One place that is most dangerous for anybody who is going to rig elections in this country is going to be River State, because our people are as determined as iron to make sure that one vote must count, every single vote.
And I'm sure you saw INEC last week on the program, and they put the issue of security on the doorstep as the reason why that election hadn't held. And for now, they are ready to go with December 10. Do you think that it was truly unsafe before now for elections to hold in Rivers?
No, it was never unsafe. You know, Suleiman, you have conducted interviews in Port Harcourt. We have your correspondent in Port Harcourt. We have all kinds of people working, you know, in Port Harcourt. We've never had serious security breaches. No place in the world is safe. Look at in the Northeast. You know, over you know, 60,000 people have been killed in the past 7 years by Boko Haram insurgency. And they organized elections there. It's incredible that INEC has in fact organized elections as far and as dangerous a place as Sambisa Forest.
That was a different leadership. Do you think now the issue has to do with the question of leadership of INEC?
Look, we have lost every confidence, not just the River State government. We have, the Nigerians have progressively lost confidence in INEC as an institution. This is the same INEC that conducted elections in Borno State, conducted elections in Adamawa State, conducted elections in some of these most volatile places. These are not places I say are volatile. These are places we know are war zones. They've collected results, counted them, declared people winners. You have Port Harcourt, River State, the oil and gas hub of the country. We generated more than 51% of the revenue of the Federation account. There has been no problem there. Until at a time when we are about to conduct elections, and the indications are very clear that the APC is going to manifestly be losing, all of a sudden they come up with this boogeyman calling security.
INEC did say they had consulted widely, including perhaps suggesting they consulted with your party as well before they fixed December 10 for the elections. Is your party ready for that?
We've always been ready. You know, not just our party, the people of River State are ready. They've always been ready for these elections. The kind of inconclusiveness that we've seen as a pattern with INEC, you know, it's just irresponsible. I mean, look at the soundbite the INEC official was, you know, just putting out, you know, during the break. He was suggesting that the inconclusiveness, in fact, arises because the elections have become more competitive. And I think that's just nonsense. I mean, we watch football matches. I mean, what can be more competitive than football matches? Do they always end up as inconclusive? So these are just the things. The fact, sadly, Chamberlain, is that, you know, we're about to lose our democracy. We have a party that says it wants to bring change. And the change that we are seeing is just scandalous. They've moved from being a party of change to a criminal syndicate, where they are now establishing industrial complexes to forge election results in anticipation of certain outcomes. They are trying to make sure that the kind of democracy that people fought for, this is not about PDP or APC. I'm more worried about the direction of this country under the APC. This has been
but
a scandal.
Isn't it also largely because of the way politicians conduct themselves and how what they even tell their followers?
And that is why we have the INEC. The INEC is supposed to be the independent arbiter in this otherwise competitive process. And now a situation arises where INEC becomes a participant in this kind of mess. How can, you know, a party organize this kind of industrial skill fraud, get people to begin to, you know, print sensitive INEC materials? I mean, these are materials which by law are supposed to be in the exclusive custody of INEC. Now, a party already knows in advance what particular units will be hosting the elections.
But the police,
and then they prepare these results, they prepare these materials in advance of the results themselves. And you come on radio, on national platform to say PDP orchestrated this, the River State government orchestrated, it's nonsense.
I did also ask Honorable Goma if he wasn't hasty, because the police, if they are investigating, if you make such comments as this, is that not also being hasty?
No, because those fellows are already, as I speak, they are in police custody. They are not in the government house. They are not in the custody of the PDP. The police is keeping them in custody because the police recognizes that what they did was clearly illegal.
No, I'm talking about for you to have come to that conclusion,
yes,
that INEC should or could have been the one to have supplied them those information with which they're working with.
You see, in the electoral process, there are certain information you don't get. Only INEC has them. For instance, there are certain security codes that we as participants in the process will not have Only INEC has them. Even when INEC has them, INEC doesn't necessarily keep these things in their offices because of the danger of compromise. They keep them in CBN vaults, and because they want to make sure that the process should be as good as the integrity that it has. This is not what we are seeing.
Now, connect the dots for us here, because if we say River State has always been peaceful, how do you link that with the number of people coming up to renounce their membership of courtist, court groups and even submission of arms in the state?
You know, in River State, we haven't created heaven. There are problems. We've got sporadic cases of criminality, just as you will find everywhere in the world. I used to live here in Lagos, you know, and I know that there are certain places in Lagos, even now, you can't go. I mean, in the Mile 12 area, for instance, just last year, there was this intercommunal clash between the Igbos and Hausas. 13 people were killed on the spot, 40 cars bombed. If you go to Ikorodu area, there is a whole area that looks like a kidnapper's den. There are all kinds of things. There have been aerial bombardments here in Lagos, you know, trying to chase our criminals. So we have situations like that in Lagos, and yet Lagos has not been...
I don't know about that. Aerial bombardment?
Yes, I mean, they were bombarding the so-called militants in some sections of Apapa, some sections of Ajengule, and the rest of them said they were fighting criminals. If you go to Kaduna, there is a low-grade insurgency already underway. In the whole of the Northeast, as I said, over 70,000 people have been killed in the past 7 years.
So what's
the point I'm making is that in River State we understand, you know, that we need to deal with this problem of crime and criminality in two ways. One, we could pursue retributive justice by saying that, look, if you commit crime, we are going to hold you accountable and you'll be brought to justice. But we also understand that sometimes criminality is induced by economic deprivation. And so the governor says, look, what we are going to do, we are going to give you a pathway out of crime. So we are going to give we are going to roll out the amnesty program. The reason is to make sure that we don't look at this in the very limited sense of law and order. We are looking at it as a sociological symptom of economic deprivation. So we are going to allow you to leave the path of criminality, and we are going to give you vocational and entrepreneurial support. This is our approach. Right. We are not giving cash for ammunition or arms. What we are going to do is to say, look, if you surrender your arms, we are going to give you vocational support so that you can have a legitimate source of livelihood.
Magwe.
Well, you know that there have been questions raised on that as well in terms of the sincerity of the people who are supposed to be taking this amnesty. I think that on more than one occasion you hear the special advisor on amnesty matters saying that to those of you who are bringing fake arms here, who are not submitting the things that you're supposed to submit, you know, there is also a question in terms of how that has been accepted and whether or not it's having any effect whatsoever. But then, you know, for some people it raises a larger question, because when a program is big enough, or when the program is, you know, wide enough to take cultists from across the state, I don't think that you have this restricted to any area in River State. And then there are questions as to, you know, what could have been transpiring in the state before now.
As I said, we've got this, we've got problems with security in some areas. You know, Ahoda West, Ahoda East, the Che areas. You know, and that is why we came up with this statewide amnesty program. It's got a window of 60 days. It's not going to run ad infinitum. It's going to be for about 60 days or so. What we are doing is to make sure that the amnesty program itself is populated by people who have security background. In fact, to my knowledge, there's only just the chairman of the amnesty program that is a civilian. The rest are military and security personnel. There will be security vetting of these individuals who are surrendering arms. There will be background checks. There will be a very serious, rigorous vetting process. That's one part. The second part is that when they surrender their arms, we are going to have a very elaborate rehabilitation scheme. But you see, to do that, there are all kinds of things that are going to come in place. We are going to give them a vocational and entrepreneurial support so that when they come, they'll be able to say, look, I want to be this, and then we'll be able to, you know, put you through a certain screening process and give you that kind of support. Look at what has happened even before the amnesty program. The governor took a loan, a grant of about 2 billion naira from the central bank, and you know what he did with it? He said, look, he was going to give entrepreneurial support to micro and small scale business owners. 35,000 people have benefited so far. So okay, we already have a history of giving this kind of entrepreneurial support, and all those who genuinely forsake their criminal ways are going to be supported in all the same way.
We have to anchor at that point and look forward to peaceful elections in River State. Well, Dr. Austin Tam George is the Commissioner for Information in River State. Thank you for coming on this morning.
Thanks for having me.